Section 1 of Commentary on the Epistle of Paul to the Colossians. Commentary on the Epistle of Paul to the Colossians by John Calvin, translated by Reverend John Pringle. The Argument on the Epistle of Paul to the Colossians. There were three neighboring cities in Phrygia, as made mention of by Paul in this epistle, Laodicea, Hierapolis, and Colossae, which, as Orosius informs us, were overthrown by an earthquake in the times of the Emperor Nero. Accordingly, not long after this epistle was written, three churches of great renown perished by a mournful as well as horrible occurrence, a bright mirror truly of divine judgment, if we had but eyes to see it. The Colossians had been, not indeed by Paul, but with fidelity and purity by Epaphras, and other ministers instructed in the gospel, but immediately afterwards Satan had, with his tares, crept in, Matthew 13:25, according to his usual and invariable manner, that he might there pervert the right faith. Some are of the opinion that there were two classes of men that endeavored to draw aside the Colossians from the purity of the gospel, that, on the one hand, the philosophers, by disputing in reference to stars, fate, and trifles of a like nature, and that the Jews, on the other hand, by urging the observance of their ceremonies, had raised up many myths with the view of throwing Christ into the shade. Those, however, who are of the opinion are influenced by a conjecture of exceedingly little weight, on the ground that Paul makes mention of thrones and powers and heavenly creatures. For as to their adding also the term elements, it is worse than ridiculous. As, however, it is not my intention to refute the opinions of others, I shall simply state what appears to me to be the truth, and what may be inferred by sound reasoning. In the first place, it is abundantly evident from Paul's words that those profligates were intent upon this, that they might mix up Christ with Moses, and might retain the shadows of the law along with the gospel. Hence it is probable that they were Jews. As, however, they colored over their fallacies with specious disguises, Paul on this account calls it a vain philosophy, Colossians 2:8. At the same time, in employing that term, he had in his eye, in my opinion, the speculations with which they amuse themselves, which are subtle, it is true, but at the same time useless and profane. For they contrived a way of access to God through means of angels, and put forth many speculations of that nature, such as are contained in the books of Dionysius, on the celestial hierarchy, drawn from the school of the Platonists. This, therefore, is the principal object at which he aims, to teach that all things are in Christ, and that he alone ought to be reckoned amply sufficient by the Colossians. The order, however, which he follows is this. After the inscription usually employed by him, he commends them with the view of leading them to listen to him more attentively. He then, with the view of shutting up the way against all new and strange contrivances, bears testimony to the doctrine which they had previously received from Epaphras. Afterwards, in entreating that the Lord would increase their faith, he intimates that something is still wanting to them, that he may pave the way for imparting to them more solid instruction. On the other hand, he extols with suitable commendations the grace of God towards them, that they may not lightly esteem it. Then follows the instruction in which he teaches that all parts of our salvation are to be found in Christ alone, that they may not seek anything elsewhere, and he put them in mind that it was in Christ that they had obtained every blessing that they possessed, in order that they might the more carefully make it their aim to retain him to the end. And truly, even this one article were of itself perfectly sufficient to lead us to reckon this epistle, short as it is, to be an inestimable treasure, for what is of greater importance in the whole system of heavenly doctrine than to have Christ drawn to the life, that we may distinctly behold his excellence, his office, and all the fruits that arise to us from it? For in this respect especially we differ from Papists, that while we are both of us called Christians and profess to believe in Christ, they picture to themselves one that is torn, disfigured, divested of his excellence, denuded of his office, in fine, such as to be a specter rather than Christ himself. We, on the other hand, embrace him such as he is here described by Paul, loving and efficacious. This epistle, therefore, to express it in one word, distinguishes the true Christ from a fictitious one, than which nothing better or more excellent can be desired. Towards the end of the first chapter, he again endeavors to secure authority for himself from the station assigned him, and in magnificent terms extols the dignity of the gospel. In the second chapter, he opens up more distinctly than he had done the reason which had induced him to write, that he might provide against the danger which he saw to be impending over them, which he touches, in passing, on the affection which he cherishes towards them, that they may know that their welfare is the object of his concern. From this, he proceeds to exhortation, by which he applies the foregoing doctrine, as it were, to present use, for he bids them rest in Christ alone, and brands as vanity everything that is apart from Christ. He speaks particularly of circumcision, abstinence from food, and of other outward exercises, in which they mistakenly made the service of God to consist, and also of the absurd worship of angels, whom they put in Christ's room. Having made mention of circumcision, he takes occasion to notice also, in passing, what is the office, and what is the nature of ceremonies, from which he lays it down as a settled point that they have been abrogated by Christ. These things are treated of till the end of the second chapter. In the third chapter, in opposition to those vain prescriptions to the observance of which the false apostles were desirous to bind believers, he makes mention of those true offices of piety in which the Lord would have us employ ourselves, and he begins with the very springhead, that is, mortification of the flesh and newness of life. From this, he derives the streams, that is, particular exhortations, some of which apply to all Christians alike, while others relate more especially to particular individuals, according to the nature of their calling. In the beginning of the fourth chapter, he follows out the same subject. Afterwards, having commended himself to their prayers, he shows by many tokens how much he loves them and is desirous to promote their welfare. End of section 1. Section 2 of Commentary on the Epistle of Paul to the Colossians by John Calvin, translated by Reverend John Pringle. Chapter 1, verses 1 through 8. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, by the will of God, and Timotheus, our brother, to the saints and faithful brethren in Christ which are at Colossae, grace be unto you, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. We give thanks to God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, praying always for you, since we heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and of the love which ye have to all the saints, for the hope which is laid up for you in heaven, whereof ye heard before in the word of the truth of the gospel, which is come unto you as it is in all the world, and bringeth forth fruit as it doth also in you, since the day ye heard of it, and knew the grace of God in truth. As ye also learned of Epaphras, our dear fellow servant, who is for you a faithful minister of Christ, who also declared unto us your love in the Spirit. 1. Paul, an apostle. I have already, in repeated instances, explained the design of such inscriptions, as, however, the Colossians had never seen him, and on that account his authority was not as yet so firmly established among them as to make his private name by itself sufficient. He premises that he is an apostle of Christ, set apart by the will of God. From this it followed that he did not act rashly in writing to persons that were not known by him, inasmuch as he was discharging an embassy with which God had entrusted him. For he was not bound to one church merely, but his apostleship extended to all. The term saints, which he applies to them, is more honorable, but in calling them faithful brethren, he allures them more wittingly to listen to him. As for other things, they may be found explained in the foregoing epistles. 3. we give thanks to God. He praises the faith and love of the Colossians, that he may encourage them the more to alacrity and constancy of perseverance. Farther, by showing that he has a persuasion of this kind respecting them, he procures their friendly regards, that they may be the more favorably inclined and teachable for receiving his doctrine. We must always take notice that he makes use of thanksgiving in place of congratulation, by which he teaches us that in all our joys we must readily call to remembrance the goodness of God, inasmuch as everything that is pleasant and agreeable to us is a kindness conferred by him. Besides, he admonishes us, by his example, to acknowledge with gratitude not merely those things which the Lord confers upon us, but also those things which he confers upon others. But for what things does he give thanks to the Lord? For the faith and love of the Colossians. He acknowledges, therefore, that both are conferred by God, otherwise the gratitude were pretended. And what have we otherwise than through his liberality? If, however, even the smallest favors come to us from that source, how much more ought this same acknowledgement to be made in reference to those two gifts in which the entire sum of our excellence consists? To the God and Father. Understand the expression thus, to God who is the Father of Christ. For it is not lawful for us to acknowledge any other God than him who has manifested himself to us in his Son. And this is the only key for opening the door to us, if we are desirous to have access to the true God. For on this account also is he a Father to us, because he has embraced us in his only begotten Son, and in him also sets forth his paternal favor for our contemplation. Always for us. Some explain it thus, we give thanks to God always for you, that is, continually. Others explain it to mean, praying always for you. It may also be interpreted this way, quote, whenever we pray for you, we at the same time give thanks to God, end quote. And this is the simple meaning, quote, we give thanks to God, and we at the same time pray, end quote. By this he intimates that the condition of believers is never in this world perfect, so as not to have, invariably, something wanting. For even the man who has begun admirably well may fall short in 100 instances every day, and we must ever be making progress while we are as yet on the way. Let us therefore bear in mind that we must rejoice in the favors that we have already received, and give thanks to God for them in such a manner as to seek at the same time from his perseverance and advancement. 4. Having heard of your faith. This was a means of stirring up his love towards them, and his concern for their welfare, when he heard that they were distinguished by faith and love. And unquestionably, gifts of God that are so excellent ought to have such an effect upon us to stir us up to love them wherever they appear. He uses the expression, faith in Christ, that we may always bear in mind that Christ is the proper object of faith. He employs the expression, love towards the saints, not with the view of excluding others, but because, in proportion as any one is joined to us in God, we ought to embrace him the more closely with a special affection. True love, therefore, will extend to mankind universally, because they all are our flesh, and created in the image of God, Genesis 9:6. But in respect of degrees, it will begin with those who are of the household of faith, Galatians 6:10. 5. For the hope which is laid up for you in heaven. For the hope of eternal life will never be inactive in us so as not to produce love in us. For it is of necessity that the man who is fully persuaded that a treasure of life is laid up for him in heaven will aspire thither, looking down upon this world. Meditation, however, upon the heavenly life stirs up our affections both to worship of God and to exercises of love. The sophists pervert this passage for the purpose of extolling the merits of works, as if the hope of salvation depended on works. The reasoning, however, is futile. For it does not follow that because hope stimulates us to aim at upright living, it is therefore founded upon works, inasmuch as nothing is more efficacious for this purpose than God's unmerited goodness, which utterly overthrows all confidence in works. There is, however, an instance of metonymy in the use of the term hope, as it is taken for the thing hoped for. For the hope that is in our hearts is the glory which we hope for in heaven. At the same time, when he says that there is a hope that is laid up for us in heaven, he means that believers ought to feel assured as to the promise of eternal felicity, equally as though they had already a treasure laid up in a particular place, of which ye heard before. As eternal salvation is a thing that surpasses the comprehension of our understanding, he therefore adds that the assurance of it had been brought to the Colossians by means of the gospel, and at the same time he says in the outset that he is not to bring forward anything new, but that he has merely in view to conform them in the doctrine which they had previously received. Erasmus has rendered it the true word of the gospel. I am also well aware that, according to the Hebrew idiom, the genitive is often made use of by Paul in place of the epithet, but the words of Paul here are more emphatic, for he calls the gospel, caps, exochen, by way of eminence, the word of truth, with the view of putting honor upon it, that they may more steadfastly and firmly adhere to the revelation which they have derived from that source. Thus the term gospel is introduced by way of apposition. 6. As also in all the world, it brings forth fruit. This has a tendency both to confirm and to comfort the pious, to see the effect of the gospel far and wide in gathering many to Christ. The faith of it does not, it is true, depend on its success, as though we should believe it on the ground that many believe it. Though the whole world should fail, though heaven itself should fall, the conscience of a pious man must not waver, because God, on whom it is founded, does nevertheless remain true. This, however, does not hinder our faith from being confirmed whenever it perceives God's excellence, which undoubtedly shows itself with more power in proportion to the number of persons that are gained over to Christ. In addition to this, in the multitude of the believers at that time, there was beheld an accomplishment of the many predictions which extend the reign of Christ from the east to the west. Is it a trivial or common aid to faith to see accomplished before our eyes what the prophets long since predicted as to the extending of the kingdom of Christ through all countries of the world? What I speak of, there is no believer that does not experience in himself. Paul accordingly had it in view to encourage the Colossians the more by this statement that, by seeing in various places the fruit and progress of the gospel, they might embrace it with more eager zeal. Ox en omemnon, which I have rendered propagateur, is propagated, does not occur in some copies, but, from its suiting better with the context, I did not choose to omit it. It also appears from the commentaries of the ancients that this reading was always the more generally received. Since the day ye heard it, and knew the grace. Here he praises them on account of their docility, inasmuch as they immediately embraced sound doctrine, and he praises them on account of their constancy, inasmuch as they persevered in it. It is also with propriety that the faith of the gospel is called the knowledge of God's grace. For no one has ever tasted of the gospel but the man that knew himself to be reconciled to God, and took hold of the salvation that is held forth in Christ. In truth means truly and without pretense, for as he had previously declared that the gospel is undoubted truth, so he now adds that it had been purely administered by them, and that by Epaphras. For while all boast that they preach the gospel, and yet at the same time there are many evil workers, Philippians 3:2, through whose ignorance, or ambition, or avarice, its purity is adulterated, it is of great importance that faithful ministers should be distinguished from the less upright. For it is not enough to hold the term gospel, unless we know that this is the true gospel, what was preached by Paul and Epaphras. Hence Paul confirms the doctrine of Epaphras by giving it his approbation, that he may induce the Colossians to adhere to it, and may, by the same means, call them back from those profligates who endeavored to introduce strange doctrines. He at the same time dignifies Epaphras with a special distinction, that he may have more authority among them, and lastly, he presents him to the Colossians in an amiable aspect by saying that he had borne testimony to him of their love. Paul everywhere makes it his particular aim that he may, by his recommendation, render those who he knows serve Christ faithfully, very dear to the churches, as, on the other hand, the ministers of Satan are wholly intent on alienating, by unfavorable representations, the minds of the simple from faithful pastors. Love in the Spirit. I take to mean spiritual love, according to the view of Chrysostom, in whom, however, I do not agree in the interpretation of the preceding words. Now, spiritual love is of such a nature as has no view to the world, but is consecrated to the service of piety, and has, as it were, an internal root, while carnal friendships depend on external causes. End of section 2. Section 3 of Commentary on the Epistle to the Colossians by John Calvin, translated by Reverend John Pringle. Verses 9 through 11. For this cause we also, since the day we heard it, do not cease to pray for you, and to desire that ye might be filled with the knowledge of his will in all wisdom and spiritual understanding, that ye might walk worthy of the Lord unto all pleasing, being fruitful in every good work, and increasing in the knowledge of God, strengthened with all might, according to his glorious power, unto all patience and long-suffering with joyfulness. 9. For this cause we also. As he has previously shown his affection for them in his thanksgivings, so he now shows it still farther in the earnestness of his prayers in their behalf. And, assuredly, the more that the grace of God is conspicuous in any, we ought in that proportion specially to love and esteem them, and to be concerned as to their welfare. But what does he pray for in their behalf? That they may know God.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.